person has got a story. They've had to struggle, they've had to strive, they've had to work hard. You too can live your dreams. This is Live Your Dreams with me, Esther Michael Emeh. It comes your way on this channel every Tuesday at 11 a.m. This is a program that gives you enough to succeed. You too can live your dreams.
Look just like me.
The bigger your dream, the harder your journey. Doesn't matter how hard it looks or seems. The truth is, there's always a light at the end of the tunnel. I don't know what you want to do, I don't know what your dreams are, but there's something I'm certain of, and which is, if you believe and you don't give up on that dream, you will definitely live it through. This is Live Your Dreams, a program that tells you that you cannot give up on your goals, on your aspiration, on your desires, whatever it is at all you want to do. Once you believe, you will achieve. Of course, today I'm going to be bringing to you somebody who has lived her dream and has put all she's got into what she believed. She's used her music to reach the world, and she has taught love and understanding through it all. Today, I'm going to be bringing her to you. Stay with me, and we'll be right back.
Person has got a story. They've had to struggle, they've had to strive, they've had to work hard. You too can live your dreams. This is Live Your Dreams with me, Esther Michael Emeh. It comes your way on this channel every Tuesday at 11 a.m. This is a program that gives you enough to succeed. You too can live your dreams.
Look just like me.
I want to say thank you for joining us, and quickly, without wasting more time, help me welcome my own very special guest for today's edition on Live Your Dreams, who is no other person. Well, I call her Auntie Kitty, but she is Dr. Kitty.
Thank you, Esther.
Quickly, let us have a briefing of who Dr. Kitty Fadulu-Deen is.
Thank you, Esther. I come from Singapore. A lot of people think that I'm from China, Philippines, etc. But I'm from Singapore, of Chinese parents. Yes, there is that Chinese in me. But those of us who are Chinese from Singapore just refer to ourselves as Singaporeans, just like you do here.
You are not Mende, you're not Timney, but you are Sierra Leonean. So that's the way it is. We have many different races in Singapore, and I'm used to mixing with people from India, from Sri Lanka, from Malaysia itself, and Europeans, of course. So I've come from a cosmopolitan community, and that's the sort of thing that has made me very comfortable no matter where I find myself. And so if you ask me how I came here, I married a Sierra Leonean. Mm. You're growing up, you do what your parents tell you to do. So my father said, and he loves music, And he said, okay, you need to learn how to play an instrument, and everybody around you is playing the piano, so you take piano lessons. So being a dutiful child, you take piano lessons. So I took piano lessons from beginners to right up to diploma level, all in Singapore. And I did very well, actually. So my dad said, why don't you consider taking that as a career? Because you're a woman, and eventually you get married, and you want to do something that you can also do at home while you're looking after your children. Well, that sounded reasonable enough. And so again, being a dutiful daughter, you do what your parents ask you to do. So that's how I got into music, following it. And eventually you find that actually you do have a liking for it. You actually develop that. You have a little bit of that at the beginning, but as the doors open to you, and you find different things in music that you can actually relate to, and you do well in, then you begin to love it.
When did you decide that you wanted to go full-time into music, or take music as a career? Being a dutiful daughter, that's a different platform, you know, because you want to obey your parents. But when did you finally decide on your own by yourself to do music as a career?
Well, it was one of these things where your life comes to a point where you decide. There was the possibility that I would do something in the university, at which I was accepted to do economics, and I was also accepted to do a course in the Academy of Music. I studied in Ireland. And so at both these high institutions, they offered me a place. And then I decided that I couldn't see myself being an economist. So, and I really was enjoying playing the piano at that stage. I was enjoying playing different pieces of music from, of course, different composers in the Western classical
genre. Yeah.
So and I was pretty good at it. So I decided to take that and see how far I would get with that. Yes. And I my teacher entered me for competitions, and I won the competitions. So I was like swept by the tide and into this career, That's how it happened.
So, amongst all the countries in the world, you could have decided to settle in America, in Europe, wherever. Why Sierra Leone?
Well, as God always decides these things, and you then look back on your life and say, yes, this direction was opened up to me. I met and fell in love with a Sierra Leonean.
Please tell us where you met.
We met while we were students. We were both students in Ireland. He was a medical student in the Royal College of Surgeons in Ireland, and I was in the University College in Dublin. And so we met through various student activities. As I told you before, I'm very comfortable with different nationalities. So with all these different nationalities holding functions and activities, I was then catapulted into a position amongst the Malaysian Students Association, where I became the secretary to a person who was the president of the Malaysian Singapore Students Association. And at one point, the president of Ireland, President De Valera at that time, he had a practice of inviting international students to his, it's called the palace, Áras Anuachtarán in Irish. He invited the key persons in the various international associations. So my husband-to-be was invited as president of the Sierra Leone Students Association. And that's where we met for the first time. But we didn't take it any.
Were you there to play the piano?
No. We were just there to socialize, be seen, and be talked to, and just say nice things to each other.
What were your challenges as a young girl? I mean, apart from the fact that your father kind of swayed you, pushed you into music, what did you always want to become?
I wanted to become a teacher. I wanted to become a good teacher. That was how when I finished school, I was asked to teach in my old school because I was pretty good at my lessons and classes. I was head girl in the school, and they all taught the world of me, and so at that time, so they invited me to teach. And I found that I really enjoyed teaching. At that time, I was teaching classroom subjects. But this love of teaching, I have applied it to anything at all in my life. I can teach you how to cook some of a particular dish. I can teach you how to drive. I can teach you how to swim. Things like that, I just like to teach you. Yes, I just like. So then when it is coupled with what you are skilled at, then you go into that.
I'm sure you have some challenges coming up, but we're going to get to hear that from you when we come back from the short break. Stay with us as Live Your Dreams. And it's a program that tells you you cannot ever give up on that dream. We'll be right back.
This kid's gonna be the best kid in the world. This kid's gonna be somebody better than anybody ever knew.
I'm gonna show you how great I am.
Don't ever let somebody tell you you can't do something. You got a dream, you gotta protect it. People can't do something themselves, they wanna tell you you can't do it. Want something, go get it. Period.
Great moments are born great opportunity. And that's what you have here tonight. That's what you've earned here tonight.
That's right. I have wrestled with an alligator. I done tussled with a whale. I done handcuffed lightning, throw thunder in jail. That's bad. Only last week, I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick. I'm so mean, I make medicine sick.
Bad dude.
Bad. Fast. Last night, I cut the light off my bedroom, hit the switch, was in the bed before the room was dark.
Incredible.
Fast.
Incredible.
And you, George Foreman, all of you chumps are gonna bow when I whoop him. All of you. I know you got him. I know you got him picked, but the man's in trouble. I'm gonna show you how great I am.
Inch by inch, play by play, till we're finished. We're in hell right now, Kevin. Believe me. And we can stay here, get the kicked out of us, or we can fight our way back into the light. We can climb out of hell. One inch at a time.
And for a long time now, you've been hearing me talk about being perfect. Well, I want you to understand something. To me, being perfect is not about that scoreboard out there. It's not about winning. It's about you and your relationship to yourself and your family and your friends. Being perfect is about being able to look your friends in the eye and know that you didn't let them down because you told them the truth. And that truth is that you did everything that you could. There wasn't one more thing that you could have done. Can you live in that moment as best you can with clear eyes and love in your heart? With joy in your heart. If you can do that, gentlemen, then you're perfect.
Let me tell you something you already know. The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you gotta be willing to take the hits and not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you wanna be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
I'm too strong.
What?
I'm too strong. I'm too strong. Too strong. I want a victory.
I'm gonna show you how great I am.
I firmly believe that any man's finest hour, the greatest fulfillment of all that he holds dear, is that moment when he has worked his heart out in a good cause and lies exhausted on the field of battle, victorious.
Never give in. Never give in. Never, never, never. In nothing, great or small, large or petty, never give in except to convictions of honor and good sense. Never yield to force. Never yield to the apparently overwhelming might of the enemy.
Men will still say, this was their finest hour.
What are we doing live? Echoes in eternity.
I'm going to show you how great I am.
Person has got a story. They've had to struggle, they've had to strive, they've had to work hard. You too can live your dreams. This is Live Your Dreams with me, Esther Michael Emeh. It comes your way on this channel every Tuesday at 11 a.m. This is a program that gives you enough to succeed. You too can live your dreams.
Look just like me.
Yes, people will always try to sway you and deter you and stop you. And sometimes it's not even people who become the obstacle. You become the obstacle because you're afraid of being who you so desperately want to be. This is Live Your Dreams. I'm Esther Michael Emeh, and this is a program that tells you you cannot give up. It's a program that gives you the notch to succeed. It's a program that is meant to inspire you to pursue and chase after that dream. So I still have the amazing Dr. Kitty Fadulu-Deen with us, and she's going to be telling us about her challenges growing up as a young girl. Yes, over to you, Dr. Kitty. As a young girl, what were your challenges coming up?
Mostly not knowing what was ahead of me. That was one big challenge. You know, I was brought up in a kind of an authoritarian kind of society, which is the same in Sierra Leone. When you're brought up that way, you do what you're told. So, and you very seldom question what is around you and what is happening.
And
so,
why you should do what
Yes, exactly. People don't give you reasons why you shouldn't do it. They say at the dinner table, don't talk. You're not supposed to talk, so you don't talk. You just eat your food. And then it is later in life that you decide, you discover that they tell you not to talk because you might swallow something inadvertently if you decide to talk and eat at the same time. So there's wisdom behind everything they tell you not to do, but sometimes they themselves don't feel like explaining things to you. So that in a way is a challenge because you grow up with these don't do's and you don't do, but eventually how do you pass this on to your next generation? You actually, because the next generation is a why generation, they ask questions, so you have to find out why something is before you tell them not to do. Otherwise, don't say that. That's what I think. Anyway, so when you growing up as a girl too, you have challenges in that you are aware you're a girl, you're aware you're growing up, you're aware you're in getting into puberty, etc., etc., and you're aware that your family are watching, looking, watching over you, and giving you rules, especially where boys are concerned.
So, no, right?
So you don't go out till over midnight. You must tell people at home exactly where you are and who you're with. And with my family at home, we were always asked to bring our friends back here. The parents had to see your friends. You can't just leave the house and go somewhere where they don't know who you're going to. So if you like to call that a challenge, that could be called a challenge. But again, you did not have that freedom, which young people have nowadays, of getting to know the people of the opposite sex. You get to know the people of your sex very easily, but the people of the opposite sex is not easy to know them.
Yeah, you came to Sierra Leone and you're one of the founders of the Ballanta Academy of Music. Tell us more about that.
Yes, I am a co-founder. My co-founder was the late Lodgie Wright. He and I are both music educators. He too liked to teach, and he always considered himself a teacher. Yes, so we met at Milton Magai Teachers College. He actually headhunted for me to go and teach there when he heard that I was in town. And you know, music teachers are very rare specimens in this society. So as soon as he was head of department then, he was the first head of department, he opened the department and so on. So he, of course, was looking for people to support his work, and he saw that I had the correct qualifications, etc. So he invited me to go to the department, and I spent nice many years there and worked with him, learned a lot, and got to know what the work was all about. Then when he retired, he was about to retire, I was invited to take over the department. Then we decided that we should try to do something out of the college, because there were a lot of people, many, many musicians, who were playing music and performing with not very much formal music education. And we could recognize that there was a lot of talent. And we said to each other, suppose we taught them, they would excel much, much more. The whole horizon would open up to them. So we decided to open a music school. And this was the main aim, so that people who needed to know more and could come and they could avail of our knowledge and experience, such as it was. So that's why we started the Ballanta Academy of Music, and we wanted to give it an African name. We didn't want to just say Sierra Leone School of Music. We wanted to make it much more African sounding and meaningful to Sierra Leone. So we chose, Lodgie had been, he was also very, very close to the late Pa Ballanta, who taught in the grammar school, who was a musician and a church person as well, and wrote music and operas and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And so we said, yes, why don't we call it after him? because his name sounds African and he has something to do with, a lot to do with music. So we decided to use his name to name the school, the Ballanta Academy of Music. That's how it started, really. And we then had to look for a place. And we decided it can't be out of town because people wouldn't find it easy to get to town. And the whole aim was to target as many young people or those who wanted to know much more about music as possible. So we looked around and we heard that there was this building in Liverpool Street. And the then government was the NPRC. So we wrote a letter to Captain Valentine Strasser at the time, telling him what we wanted to do and asking him for a place, that if good government could identify a place for us. And so this place in Liverpool Street, which still belongs to the Freetown City Council, was identified for us. So we started to negotiate terms and so on with the then Freetown City Council, whose chairperson, mayor then, was Miss Florence Dilsworth, who again was a great lover of music. And so she supported us very much. And so we started it there. And of course, after we had discussed the whole idea, we formed a board of directors comprising several people who were either musicians themselves or had their hearts in music and were influential in other ways. We had people like the late Ebun Thomas, we had Mrs. Joyce Samake, the late Mike Ford, Mr. Tani Pratt, he's still our chairman this time. And we had Baramasi Madi, he's not in town anymore, and a few other people who are either the late William Conton, Dr. Conton, and some have left now.
What would you say made you decide to just do music full-time as a career?
Because I enjoyed it, and because I could see that I was helping a lot of people, and music that applies to Sierra Leone is not just playing classical music. I discovered that I really enjoyed the Sierra Leonean traditional music, and I thought that it was so special that I'd never heard drums played so well and so distinctly and confidently, and I'd never seen so many good dancers as I see here, and singers in the church, they're beautiful voices. And so I said to myself, you know, I can really enjoy being in this kind of career, and I can organize. That's another thing about me, that I like to organize events so that I could then invite people to perform in front of other people and invite other people to enjoy in their music. And there are a lot of people here who appreciate that. Appreciate being invited. If they don't themselves play an instrument, they enjoy listening to band music, they enjoy listening to pop band music, cultural music, and classical music. There is less on that field, but they still enjoy it.
How many years have you been into music?
Oh, my dear. I have been in this country since 1970. And in this country, I have been in music. I started actually teaching music before I came here. After I finished my master's, I was asked to go back to teach in the university. So I started then, and it was then that I found that I had this ability, and I enjoyed imparting knowledge. Mm-hmm. And what I couldn't impart, I would find out, and then I enjoyed seeing the student, you know, see the light, so to speak, and apply the knowledge and really appreciate what he or she has learned.
So
I enjoy that.
You didn't have any challenge coming in from Singapore and certainly in Sierra Leone with the different kind of music?
Yes, well, you know, it is different, but it's all the same in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. There is there are what we call lines in music. There is a dominance and there is rhythm, and there is interplay of all sorts of harmonies, textures, etc. in any kind of music. You find it in jazz, you find it in church music, in classical music, of course. And so all this, and traditional music here, if you listen to the drums, drum lines, you hear every single
line very distinctly, and each of them has a role to play to complement the whole. Mm-hmm. So music is actually a very good discipline
in that you have your part, but you belong to the whole, and you cannot mess it up, because you're going to mess up the whole if you mess your part up. So you've got to be focused, and you've got to listen to everybody else doing their thing, and to be alert in case you have to adjust because somebody decided to do something that he or she decided to do at that point. So you have to be quick. And it's actually very, very exciting for the intellect and for the emotions. There are interplays of volume. You can go louder, softer, middle way. And all this is very interesting for the listener and for the person who is in the music at that time. So there are different types of pieces to play. And different types of dances that go with the pieces. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and you can also do your own thing. You can actually compose your own, and according to the style that you like best, you can compose your own. So there's no boundaries particularly. You know, you can be free and you can be confined as you wish.
Well, what would you say has been your greatest achievement so far?
Well, okay, in lots of ways, I don't have one greatest one. I have like peaks in my time. I have peaks like I took a group to Malaysia, a group of 21 of us. That was a very exciting time because A, we raised enough money for them to go. That was a big factor. We raised out a lot of money, and then we did a great performance. They'd never heard anybody from Sierra Leone before. So, and we go down in their annals of history as coming from Sierra Leone. And then we also came back. All of us came back. You know, the time here is like when you have a group going out of Sierra Leone, you wonder whether they'll all come back. So that was a big achievement that we all came back. So that was one highlight. The second highlight that I always have enjoyed a lot was going with the Milton Magai School for the Blind on their tour in 2007. So we went to Malaysia in 2006, and I was with the Milton Magai School for the Blind in 2007. Now, why do I like that occasion? It's because I have been working with this group of amazing musicians. All have either they're totally blind or they have trouble seeing, and they are so keen in their hearing, you and I would never match up to what they could hear. And you teach them once, you sing the something once, you sing the something twice, and they've got it. They can sing it back to you. I mean, teaching them is much easier than teaching people who can see. Honestly, and they catch it, and they repeat the lines, and then you ask them two parts together, they sing two parts together, three parts and four parts, play the instrument, and so it was like amazing. Then, I know that they have been on tours before, but what they did was simply stand on the stage and sing. So I decided that I would choreograph them. That's another offshoot of what I have been doing. I decided to just see what they could do, even though they couldn't see. And so I put into their pieces movement. Simple but achievable movements. But it created a visual interest from the audience point of view, because they not only heard the nice singing, they could see that they were they were able to do things. And any time they moved, you could hear the audience go, like this. So it was, that for me was a big achievement. So I enjoyed that. And so that was another thing. And of course, all through the years, whenever I put people through examinations and international exams at that, like you, and they pass, and they pass well, and I feel really good that I have given them something in their lives that they have treasured.
I thought you were going to mention the book you just wrote.
Yes, that was my latest thing. That was my latest thing. It's not going to be my last, but it's my latest thing. And that I started writing this book. It was like, you have an idea. You look around you and you say, what can I do that hasn't been done before? What can I do? I don't want to repeat what others have done, because you don't reinvent the wheel. You have to put something to match everything else, or to show everything where it can go to, that can be possible. So then I started to talk to one or two people. One of them was Handel Wright, because I wanted to identify musicians' families. I realized there are families that have blood running through them that is musical, so to speak. Like the Wright family, there are Jones family, and a couple other families that have, a Renner family. They have music in their genes. So I started with this Wright family, and I talked to Handel Wright, and he gave me lots of information, not only about his family, but himself as well. So I started to take that down. Then I asked him to just help me put it all down more accurately. So he did. And then that then gave me the interest to seek out more information. As soon as he mentioned some orchestra or some group, I would try to find somebody linked to that group. And this is how it snowballed.
So what's the aim of the book?
The aim of the book is to record, just simply to document this rich period in Sierra Leone's music history, from around the 65 to 70 to 2000, where there were lots and lots of live bands. When I first came to this country in 1970, and between 70 to 75, we were young in those days, and we loved to listen to bands. There's a band playing in the village. We were in Lunza at that time. The band playing in the village, Saturday night, we'd all organize ourselves, find a babysitter and go to the band and dance. These bands like Orchestre Mouillet, Afro National, they would play, and they would play really, really good music. And so this is the history that I'm not sure, I don't say they don't know, I'm not sure that they do. The young people nowadays who are musicians, who are recording, etc., and in a totally different style. I'm not sure that they realize that there was this period in music history that was amazing. And we had people who could play the guitar, like Freddie Green. He played really, really amazing things, up and down on the guitar, and till the crowd really goes wild when they hear this guitar solo going. Anyway, so I decided to document it, because these musicians themselves, I don't really think they would have the idea or the time to actually write about themselves. Maybe one or two, but not the whole lot of them. So this is why I started to do that. And I said, you know, when you look up under Sierra Leone music in the internet, you don't really get anything. So what about if I produce something that will actually be something that could represent some part, little part of Sierra Leone's music that people who want to research about Sierra Leone and its music can refer to. So this is how it just snowballed into a book. And so that's how I, and actually, it was actually fun in the end. It was hard going. At some point, you almost give up because you can't see the end of it. But after a while, all of a sudden, it's like climbing up a hill. This is an image that somebody gave me. It's not my original image. You go up a hill, you go like 3/4 of the way up the hill, and you go, you're really trying to get to the top. So by the time you almost want to sit down and just give up and go downhill again. But then you try, and when you get up to the top, then you have achieved something. The view from there is fantastic.
Well, what would you say has been your support, your inspiration?
Oh, okay. Of course, my late husband was always there for me. He's always encouraging me. He knows when I go and interview somebody and so on and so forth. But the musicians themselves were very happy that I was doing this. So this gave me a lot of support and the will to go on, because then I know that they appreciate what I'm doing for them. I said, you're going to be in this book. So they say, wow, you know, and they said, then they're happy to tell me more about it. The only regret I have is a lot of them didn't have photographs, but some of them did have photographs. And one photograph, which I have in the book, shows this huge instrument, which you don't see much now. It's this big double bass that was part of the pop band in those days. It was Eddie Ewa. He was from Nigeria, but he was performing in Sierra Leone. So nowadays you have the bass guitar replacing this huge double bass. So, and that is the original sound.
Please, could you give us names of the musicians that you featured in your book?
Well, I may not remember all, but there are a whole lot of them. There is Francis Fuster, who belongs to the band that was going was, and first of all, there was Dr. Dynamite. He was a very big, he's still alive, he's in America, and I spoke to him over the phone, and he was telling me all about the many bands he formed. Thank you. Then there's the Golden Strings, that a lot of people in the Golden Strings. There was Abu White and his orchestre, yeah. And there's Afro National, there's Sabano 75, there's Afro Combo.
I'm guessing there's Lodgy Wright.
Sorry?
I said, I'm guessing there's Lodgy Wright.
No. Lodgy never played in a band. he was a great singer, though. Yeah. Yeah, so there are many. And there is Purple Haze. This is the band that Dr. Spencer mentioned at the book launching. And that was Raymond Sayoun, or otherwise known as De Breeze, that's what they call him. He's still alive, and I had hoped that he would be at the book launch, but he's gone to the Lebanon now. Mm-hmm. But he also played the guitar and sang. And there's also, of course, Steady Bongo is in the book, and Jimmy B is in the book. Right up to Jimmy P, that's where I stopped, actually.
All right, what would you say you still want to achieve? What would you say is left of you to do as
okay,
a musician
I still,
and as,
yeah.
as a teacher?
Well, I think as a teacher, maybe I will take a back seat now. But as a musician, I still want to see if I can now go into editing, actually film editing. I've discovered that I like to make my own films, and I like to sit and edit them.
I think
them.
You should talk to Suleiman Stevens about that.
Who?
He can really help you, Suleiman Stevens.
Oh, okay. Definitely. Then I have a couple books in the bag. So to speak, I started 2 more books, but I won't tell you about them.
No, it's okay. No trouble. I'm sure I'll get to have you again talk about your books in maybe subsequent edition of this program. Mm-hmm. Looking back in your life from where you started and where you are now, what would you want to change?
I would want to, well, let me say, I would want to change a little of me, I think.
What exactly? Tell us.
A little of me in that I wish I were a little bit more aggressive. I am a little bit too laid back sometimes in my later years, and I wish I had been a little bit more pushful. But there were things in my life that came into my life, and I guess you have to deal with things as they come, and you have to lay aside things when you're not able to do that. So I do, though, want, I hope, that we can aim and get land to build a new academy. I think that's something I haven't been able to do, and that is much to my regret. I will say yet, so because I haven't given up that. I have in my mind a huge campus, you know, a land for a campus, and where we will have teaching rooms, practice rooms, an open air place for the indigenous musicians, a workshop to make our own instruments, an auditorium, a place for a volunteer to stay, and a library, and an IT place that people can go to the computer and compose music. Nowadays, you know, you can compose at the computer. So we'll encourage the next generation to do that a lot. So I still hold that dream. And as long as there's life in me, I still would like to push somehow from the sides.
I'm gonna support you.
So that is my aim, and it will be, you know, something very worthwhile for this country. Second thing that I haven't been able to do, and that is to spread outside of Freetown, and that's because we do not have the capacity. That's another thing that is a little bit disappointing, in that we don't have enough staff and enough qualifications for staff to be able to spread them outside of Freetown. The last time we went to Bo, we were asked there if we could please set up there, and I said, well, we are thinking about it, but we don't really know how yet to go about it. They want to learn music, they want to learn how to read, how to play interesting music, and just to grow musically. And that's just Bo. Who knows what's happening in Makeni? Who knows what's happening in Kenema? There's so many people to help. And I think the government needs to find focus and a purpose for doing this as a government, because so far we've all been operating on the sidelines.
Sure.
We've been asking the government for help. Sometimes the subventions don't come on time, like right now we don't get our subvention. We cannot work without money. If we don't get the money, we cannot even operate. Yeah, that is another thing that is disappointing, that if we could have a lot of money, we manage that fund and we can grow. We can support all the young people who want to play instruments.
Professionally,
exactly. They can have their own bands, they can, you know. There are a lot of young people who have...
People like me, yeah? Go ahead.
Yeah, who have nothing... I mean, who would really like to do that.
Music.
In the same way that they would like to play sports and all kinds of things.
Yeah.
But we are handicapped. Yeah. We, as a people here, we are totally sidelined in that area. We have... Look at the artists, for example. In NPRC time, you could see the artists simply splurge. They just... expose themselves. They were so talented, they made murals all over the city. And that is, we never knew that these artists were there. I mean, so talented. In the same way, you have young people who cannot afford even the very basic lesson that you could give them. They need to be supported. They need to have a place where they can come in when they're free, pick up an instrument, blow, 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 or play, 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 and then they grow, and others will help them. You know, we need centers.
All
not just one, many centers like that. And also for adults to really revise their thinking that music is for people who don't know how to do anything else. I really think that...
Please, just say that again, please, so they can hear.
That music is for people who don't know how to do anything else. Why? You really need a brain, a really highly charged brain to do music. Or to dance. Or to beat the drum or whatever, you know. You can't do it yourself. So why don't you admire and why don't you encourage your family to go into music? You see, the funny thing is, any time a stranger asks me, for example, what do? I say, I teach music, and immediately their face goes into a smile. Oh, music, you know. So why are they reacting like that if, on the other hand, they turn and say, don't go do music? Why? You know, I don't understand that. So music should be the main thing you think about. Because your brain, having done some music, is already very, very charged to do some other thing. You don't have to find a whole career in music. You use that time that you've been studying music to translate into another skill. You could be a great engineer,
whatever you want to do. I'm sure you support the fact that I believe that music and even cultural studies should be included in the school's
educational
curriculum.
Definitely. And if they ask you, well, where are the teachers? Well, yes, all the teachers are the ones, you know, in the music field right now, the groups, the dance groups and so on, you use them to teach. You teach them how to teach.
That could also be a way to even employ young people.
Exactly.
Empower them.
Employ them and give them dignity, because if they sit around and do, and they feel hopeless about their future, you give them a future. And they start there. Who knows where they will end up, you know.
So when you get to the point where you want to give up, what do you do?
When I want to give up? Yes. Well, I have grandchildren. I'm going to teach them. Yes. I have, you know, I've lived out here for long, and my own family has missed out on me a lot. So I think it's time I turn my attention to my own family. And I don't know, maybe it's just for a while. Maybe again, I find myself doing another. I know now that I can't plan the future. I can just live the present. It took me a long while to understand that. But now I understand that fully. I used to hear people and read it in books about, don't worry about the past because it's done. Don't worry about the future because you don't know what's going to happen. Just live in the present. And so that's what I aim to do.
Yeah, Dr. Kitty Fadulu-Deen, this is a program that inspires people across the world, tries to encourage young, old, whoever, you know, to tell them that they should live their dream, live in the present, you know, not give up, not hold back, not try to copy what somebody else has done, like you earlier said, but to do something that has not been done before. And it takes a lot of courage and strength. And would I say determination to do this. So I want you to say maybe your last 2-3 words or more to somebody out there who probably wants to give up on their goal, on their dream.
Okay, it's like this in life. You do something, and if it's easy and it keeps on going forward, then you're meant to do that. That's, if you have a goal to reach, you go that way. If you get to a point where you have lots of what I call blocks, you don't give up. You just find another way to achieve your aim. Because it's never smooth riding. It's never smooth riding. There will be circumstances in your life, personal or otherwise, that may come into the picture, But what you have to do is to remember that what you want to do is something in your heart that you want to do, mm-hmm. and that you love doing, and that you feel already in your heart that you can do it. So you do it, and as I said, if you get to a point where you find that, oh dear, I want to give up this, try to think, and you have the capacity in you to rethink your strategy. Just your strategy, that's all, because there's no one way to anything. There's several ways. And sometimes somebody may just drop a word or a phrase, just casually, within your hearing that might help you. Or you listen to a TV program that somebody's saying something that suddenly makes you feel, oh, maybe I could try that. Or you read something in a newspaper somehow and you say, oh yes, I never thought about that. What about me trying that? So there are very many different ways, as they say, to achieve your aim, and you need to go with that. But most of all, you have to have it in your heart. You have to feel it in your heart, in your very being, that what you're doing is nice, it's good, and it's going to work. That's what you have to work to understand and believe.
Okay, last question before you finally leave. What's your favorite food?
My favorite what? Food?
Food, yes. Coming from Singapore and Sierra Leone.
Well, I like shrimps. I like any dish that you make with shrimps. Doesn't matter. I am very easy with food. I like my own food from my own country, but I don't crave for it. If it's not there, it's not there. I'm not going to die because it's not going to be here. I've learned to love the plasasses here. I've learned to cook them. I can eat that. I can eat most different foods, really. And so I think I like shrimps.
All right. Thank you so much for taking out your time to be with us here. And I think I've actually learned a lot. These very short moments, and I've been inspired. One thing I can definitely remember is there are many ways to get in there. So if you get to a roadblock and it feels like you can't, it's either you go around it, you jump over it, or just find a way, or you swim through it. Thank you, Dr. Kitty, for being with us.
Thank you for inviting me.
And finally, to you watching, I hope you've been inspired. This is a program that is meant to, you know, meant to make you tick, you know what I mean? To help you wake up from that sleep. To help you come to the realization that yes, your dream might be really big and drowning, but once you are ready, once you are determined, once you believe, once you shut everything out, every other wrong voice telling you to quit, and you stay true to yourself and you walk towards that goal, you will definitely get to the end of it. I mean, this is a show where I bring different people from different walks of life. I mean, I have to fly cross country to get people through to you. Just so I tell you that there is nothing that you put your heart to that you cannot achieve. You just have to dream it, you have to believe it, you have to stay focused on it, and you have to walk towards it consistently. So when you sleep, even with your eyes open, excuse me, don't forget to always tell yourself that I can, I will, and I will not give up. I'm Esther Michael Emeh, and I'm not giving up on you, so you can't give up on yourself either. I want to say thank you to my wonderful crew who's behind the camera right now. Thank you so much for your work, and I want to say to you, do not give up. This is Live Your Dreams that comes your way on Channels 101 every Tuesday. Of course, you can follow me on Facebook at www.liveyourdreamswithesthermichaelemeh.com. Watch it and follow me on my YouTube channel, Esther Michael, and of course on Google Plus. I am forever your humble host on this show, Live Your Dreams. Until I come your way again, do not give up. Thank you.
person has got a story. They've had to struggle, they've had to strive, they've had to work hard. You too can live your dreams. This is Live Your Dreams with me, Esther Michael Emeh. It comes your way on this channel every Tuesday at 11 a.m. This is a program that gives you a nut to succeed. You too can live your dreams.
Look just like me.
You can live your dreams.